Salutations, Celestial Sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Well, most of you are likely to get some sort of telescope and or accessory that you will be able to use to help you observe the outside over our heads. Yes, this guy too. So, what are the best things to look at when you are able to go outside and take a look? Let's consider some of the options that are out there. The first thing that most people are going to think of is the moon. I can see the moon because it will be full on Christmas Day, which most people will think, hey, this is a great time to see the moon. Let's see why that's actually not the case. When you zoom in on the moon, you can notice that there's really not a whole lot of detail. Now, Stellarium here doesn't show it all that well in this particular rendering. It used to show it better for some reason. It washes out completely. But the truth is, even at the telescope, number one, a low-power view like this is going to wash out a lot anyway, and there's really no shadows, so there's not much to see. So the best thing to do is wait a day. And I know you're thinking, why wait a day? Well, first of all, you want to eat dinner with family or whomever else is around and sharing the time with you. So eat dinner with them and then wait till the next day. And you see what happens to the moon here. Notice how we get this shadowed section. If we zoom in on that a little bit, we can see that details start to pop up like craters and things. So that is really what is going to be better to see on the moon, is those shadowed areas. Now, what else can we see out in the night sky? Well, because the moon is full, it's going to wash out a lot of the stars and dimmer objects. However, there are some things to see. If we look towards the southeast, for anyone in the northern hemisphere, there's going to be a number of bright stars, and you may be thinking, okay, which one of these should I point at? Okay. To begin, look at the constellation of Orion. You can see that over here. It's going to be almost towards the south, about 4 hours or so after sunset. Excuse me, this is actually showing 6 hours after sunset. But even 4 hours after sunset, you're over in the southeast. Let's go at 9 o'clock. We can see that there's, first of all, these three bright stars in the middle. That's his belt. And then the two upper stars are his shoulders, and the two lower stars are his knees. That's Orion the Hunter. Pretty easy to find. Most people are able to find that. The beautiful thing is that if you follow a line from his belt down about 20 degrees, or two fist widths held at arm's length, distance from there over to there, you'll find the brightest star in the night sky, Sirius. And that's part of the constellation Canis Major. If we go clockwise from there and imagine that this star right here called Betelgeuse in Orion, we follow from Rigel, his knee, to Sirius, and then go clockwise up. We're going to run into Procyon, which is the first magnitude star in the constellation Canis Minor, which is the little dog. Canis Major was the big dog. If we continue on around, we find Gemini, the twins, making that clock kind of shape up and over. Now we're going to be looking almost near overhead. This is the bright star Capella, in the constellation of Auriga, the charioteer. If you can see a charioteer in that shape, more power to you. I don't see a charioteer. That's okay. It's about it's like a hexagon type shape. Continuing on around, though, in kind of our hexagon or clock shape, we then run into this star, which is also a first magnitude star, very bright, easy to see. That's Aldebaran in Taurus the Bull. And you notice in this stick figure line of Taurus, you've got the horns here going kind of inwards. There's this other line coming out, and that's because out here is the Pleiades, and you'll be able to see that. That's about 15 degrees or so away from Aldebaran, away from Orion, so you can measure that. See, that's about 13, 14 degrees. You can measure 15 degrees by holding your hand out and measuring from your forefinger to your pinky. So measure from Aldebaran out away from Orion, and you'll find the Pleiades that looks like this little tiny grouping of stars like that. Now what you'll find is that looks really small when you look at it naked eye, but when you put it in a telescope, it's actually pretty darn big, because if we go from this star across, we can see that that's more than a full degree, and most telescopes are only going to show you a full degree, maybe a little bit more than that, in the eyepiece. But this is still a great star cluster to look at. Definitely look at the Pleiades. It's about 300, 400 light years away or so. It's basically a new star cluster. It's not all that old, so it's fairly new forming. And it's also fairly bright because you can see these naked eye from most anywhere. You'll at least be able to see two or three of these stars and definitely be able to see all of them in a telescope. You just may not be able to see all of them at the same time, depending on the focal length of your telescope and what eyepiece you have. So use the longest focal length eyepiece. It'll probably have a 20 or 25 or 26 on it. Use that, put it in your telescope, aim it at the Pleiades, and take a look. The next thing that we want to look at is actually in that constellation of Orion, and we're going to look kind of under his belt area, and you'll notice that you have the three stars here that are the belt itself, and here's the other stars that form the shoulders and knees. And in between the belt stars and the knee stars, you're going to have these three stars in a line, and that's called his sword. I guess you could put the sword into the belt or something like that, into a sheath. But this middle star is the important one that we want to focus in on, and the reason why is because there's more than just one star there. To naked eye, it'll look like a single star, but this is the Orion Nebula, and if we zoom in on that, you can see, bam, all of a sudden, there's all this color and everything. Now, Stellarium fools you because you're going to see all this red here in Stellarium. That's not how it looks, trust me. Well, kids might see that much red in a really large telescope, but most of us will see gray. If your telescope's large enough, you may see some faint blue and green, and perhaps if it's very transparent and clear, a little bit of orange. But most of you will likely see a lot of a gray area with some hints of blue or green. Now, what you want to look for and what Stellarium changes because we've zoomed in is you want to change this absolute scale and relative scale, because right here, kind of in the middle of this, I'm going to back down these stars and change this absolute scale and relative scale. You can see right there, those stars, where this is showing really bright, that's going to sort of look like a hole in the nebula itself, because these stars are going to be so bright, they're going to overwhelm the nebula right in that section to your naked eye. So there sort of be this whole area, and you'll see these four stars. Those are called the trapezium, and you will want to zoom in on that. So use a higher magnification eyepiece. I'm going to zoom in just a little bit more, and you can see how there's this tiny little trapezium shape of four stars together. There's actually more stars there. Larger telescopes will show even more, but most of us will only be able to see those four. And if you can see those four, that's a really cool thing to look at in addition to the nebula itself. So that will get you going for your Christmas astronomical gift list with whatever that you are able to have this year, whether that be a telescope or eyepieces or some other accessories. That's all for this week, though. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.